This video is for people that want to know, they want to gain an intuition for whether or not the code that they're writing is code that sort of fits in with the rest of the Rust ecosystem. We're going to be going through four resources, and we're going to do it in two passes. So the first pass is going to be a very quick skim, and just to introduce you to a few things, and the second pass is going to be in more depth. Okay. Resource one, the Rust Design Patterns Guide. And the Rust Design Patterns Guide are sort of community contributed many articles. For example, we talk about how in Rust we typically use the format macro to concatenate bits and pieces of a string rather than, for example, creating some mutable object result and then pushing or growing it, expanding it with different parts. And there are a bunch of those. The API guidelines are similar, but slightly more official. These are similar in the sense that they provide a topic, and you have the first sentence is the sort of an explanation, as well as several examples. And the next resource is the Linter Clippy. And in particular, I recommend that you actually go and read through the lint index. The reason why I say this is because, yes, there are 600 things that could go wrong. There are about 600 things, probably more by the time you watch this, that Clippy is checking for. One of the ones that we're interested in, though, is the style recommendations, because the style recommendations are going to try to look for things that that are possibly not needed because you are doing something that doesn't map, that isn't needed in Rust. That, for example, if you check if your user calling is digit, and you do that with a just a character, you can actually get away with a different method that is actually slightly faster. Or if you are manually checking infinity, it turns out that you might not know that there's actually a method on floating point numbers for is infinite, and you can go through the rest of the examples if you'd like. They're actually quite useful as guidance more generally on how to write idiomatic Rust, which is the topic of this last repository. So Idiomatic Rust is a community collection of resources, which actually includes the three that we've already talked about, including Clippy, the patterns, Rust patterns doc that I started with, as well as the API guidelines, as well as a bunch more, including some really extensive self-directed learning resources. Okay, let's go through our second pass. So these Rust design patterns include a large number of idioms that talk about the way that you could do things, but the way that we recommend that you should do them. You can, for example, iterate over an option, which means that it can be used as a method to extend. You can extend a vector with some object. In that case, we're talking about computer scientists and Curry, Clean, Markov, and Turing, or logicians, I suppose, and some sort of caveats some kind of extra extra documentation relating to them. I think that you will have a lot of fun working through these, because even the rationale of these particular patterns is good to kind of internalize, because it will give you, again, a greater sense for what Rust is trying to, what Rust is attempting to achieve. And the API guidelines are even like one step more robust. They provide, in the typical case, very lengthy or comprehensive documentation, and you start to talk a little bit about, you know, connecting all the way back to RFCs or formal documents that are very large, usually, about the way Rust should work and how it should, how the Rust was designed. And the so you will find a little bit more about sort of Rust history if you look through some of these API guidelines. Cool. We've actually talked about the Clippy lints in kind of relatively high detail. I do want to point out, though, potentially just to let you know that you are able to specify you can specify versions of Rust that you would like and check whether or not that won't give us many. But you can see that over time, more and more lints have appeared. Or actually, that's quite hard to see. But the but it's interesting. At least I find it interesting. And lastly, this idiomatic Rust guide includes much more than what it says. It says that it's just guidelines for writing elegant Rust programs. It turns out that it's a guide to other guides of writing elegant Rust programs. I want to point out some of these self-directed courses. Comprehensive Rust is sponsored by Google as part, and I believe it is the internal Android team. And it's translated into multiple countries, languages. You can use it to begin to see how Rust works with C++, as well as use Rust with Android. The Build Your Own Jira with Rust is written by Luca, the author of Zero to Production, and it kind of grows it grows a task manager, which is kind of fun and interesting. In some sense, boring, because, you know, who likes tasks and issues and so forth. The Rust training material is a 3-day workshop, but I believe, and this one points to the right place, okay, because there are two. They have two repositories. One is called Rust in 3 days, and then this teaching material is a little bit is more current. Now, the Ping Cap training plan is a worked database project. They ask their new starters to build a database essentially from scratch. And David Tolney's procedural macro workshop is also quite interesting, especially if you want to start writing macros. So that's kind of neat. And it turns out that it's actually more than one project. There are 5 of them. And there's a whole bunch of books and talks and articles. I would like to give a small shout out. Actually, these are all really well selected talks. So if you are the kind of person that does enjoy watching talks online, there are multiple video links across half of YouTube that I can definitely get behind. So that is Idiomatic Rust, or at least my guide to other guides for writing idiomatic Rust, so that you look less like a tourist and feel much more at home in the Rust community. I will see you online. Take care. Bye.